Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever time you guys are watching this. Thank you guys for tuning back in. I'm hoping you guys are coming here to watch part two of part three series I have going on right now, the C4 and C5 Corvette comparison video. Last week, I put a video up of all the differences between the C4 and C5 exteriors. This video is gonna be all about the C4 and C5 comparisons with the interior. The video next week is gonna be a POV drive, which stands for point of view, in case some of you guys don't understand that or know that. Point of view drive of the C5 Corvette. I have not driven one for a long time, so I'm very excited to get to be able to drive that car. So tune in next week to watch that one. But for this video, we're going to see all the differences between the C4 and C5 interior. So let's get right to it. Alright guys, so we are now in the interior of this car. As you can see, it is totally different than the C5. The C4. Now, what's in here?
That's actually an airbag.
An airbag? What is that?
That's that thing that's supposed to help you out a little bit.
Huh, you know, it's kind of funny. My car doesn't have that, so if I get an accident, I'm kind of screwed. But I do have vents like this, but mine are down here. And I do have a glove box, but mine's up here. But I don't have this fancy little... we're going too fast grab handle.
That's the more polite way of saying it.
Yeah. So what is this thing?
Well, this is what I would call a GM afterthought.
Okay.
So it is actually a cup holder.
Notice he said cup holder, not cups holder.
To put that in there, that is about that deep. What is that, about an inch and a half?
Not even, man. That is, what the world? Like, literally a soda can, and that's about it.
Well, and that's assumed that you're going straight. And
no turns.
To retrofit this.
This is pretty cool, guys. I gotta be honest.
This is a little clip, and I can send you the information included in
the link.
Is this is called Corvette clips. So this is 3D printed, and it actually slides over here like that. So now the drink, but before being secured right there, it's actually up top, and it actually does do a really good job. So it's a good retrofit. It was about $22, and
if you use
the promo code Ship On Us, you get free shipping.
And what's this engraved on the side here?
Oh, yeah, you can actually personalize it.
Wow, it says Matt's Corvette on it.
That does.
Wow, that's really cool.
And they have like a wide variety of colors you can get as well.
So, okay, that's nice. So basically the point of this is to raise this lip up so your cup doesn't go falling over on your passenger or your floor whenever you're driving.
Yep.
Which is pretty awesome. So here's the cup holders to the C4. As you can see, there's two cup holders. This is actually a cups holder instead of the cup holder he has. But again, it's only like an inch and a half deep. Like, you can't fit much in there. On the way here, I had a little tiny coffee cup from Turkey Hill, and I had to get the small option because the bigger cup would not fit in this car. Another big change between the interior is on the C4, the emergency brake is actually on that side, and you can actually pull this up and then just push it down to get it out of the way. Here's the emergency brake I was telling you guys about. So here's whenever the emergency brake is all the way on, but to get out of the car, of course, that would be in your way. So you actually just push it down and it falls down. And then to release it, you just pull it up like this, and then that's whenever you push the button to release the brake and put it back down. But that is pretty cool. I actually like it being there. You don't have the drift car look to it. You can't pull it up to drift around turns, but when you have this kind of power, all you gotta do is step on the accelerator and it does it for you.
If you stay right there, I'll show you a little bit of a downfall of this.
Okay.
So let's say you're going somewhere and you have a passenger.
Oh yeah, he elbowed me.
So you have to kind of be a contortionist when you do this right here.
I see that. I did want to tell you guys too, this was the last model year for the C5, 2004. The next year's when we went to the C6. So this was like the last car you could get if you wanted to get a C5, and the latest one. So my favorite thing is this. I'm so glad you got a 6-speed, Matt. I know you were excited to get a 6-speed. So do you like the, does it shift nice? Do you
It actually shifts really smooth, and it's just 100% stock, no aftermarket shifter. I do plan on changing all the fluids, transmission, so when I switch to Royal Purple, it's actually supposed to make it feel just smoother.
I actually used AMSOIL when I did my transmission stuff, and I did notice a pretty nice difference. I was really happy with that.
Yeah, this thing's way out of warranty, so it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, exactly. So, okay, so quirks and features. So what about, like, this radio looks like it's what's in my dad's 1999 Silverado. Is that true?
I think it's called a Parts Bin Special. you're correct on that. I mean, there is a couple of things, like, you know, this does a radio. It works well. Actually, do I still have it back here?
Yeah.
Yep.
This thing's pretty cool.
What I bought off of this is called Amazon Special, since I was just trying this. It actually plugs into your cigarette lighter, and it's a FM Bluetooth modulator. So okay. that way you can use your radio, or excuse me, your phone hands-free, you can stream from it, so forth like that. They do make kits where you can actually send your radio, they'll drill it for auxiliary input and stuff like okay. that. But, you know, taking the dash off or part of the console, yeah. it's a little bit of a chore, and, you know, it's a little bit of money. Why not try this for $20 just to see $20. If you like it? And, you know, you have to look how often you drive a car. Most of these cars only get driven 3,000 to 6,000 miles a year, so is it really worth the time and effort?
Or if you're me, you know, you drive 1,000 miles every 4 years. But as you can see here, the radio is a lot different than his. It's not from a 1999 Silverado.
So one thing that's a little bit different about this is, and even my 2012 Dodge Challenger doesn't have this, is dual climate zones.
Oh, wow.
Yep, so
So I can have mine hot and you can have yours cold.
Yep,
it's like
Katy Perry.
Yeah, it is like Katy Perry.
The one interesting thing about this, and I've actually got the owner's information video from there, is that when you hit the defroster on, depending on what the temperature is outside, your AC actually runs.
Okay.
So there's a lot, and the reason why GM engineers did that is to make the defrosting more efficient because it actually removes the humidity out of it.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
It does not make any sense, though, when you're at 6:30 in the morning, haven't had your cup of coffee. It's like, yeah. Why the hell is the air? You can see the AC coming on.
The climate control in this car, though, you set your temperature here with your blue arrow, making it colder, of course, red arrow making it hotter. But it actually has auto, which it actually can tells that the car actually knows how high the fan should be based on the temperature you set it. So if you set the temperature to 90 degrees and it's currently 40 degrees in the car, it's going to automatically make the fan speed 10 until it gets to that temperature, and then it'll slow it down. But to turn the AC on, there's no actual AC button. It's just this button right here. And then, of course, you have your feet and your face and then feet only. You have your rear defroster, your windshield defroster, and then, of course, your off button for that.
But speaking of radio, one thing that is a little different, you have your radio that pops up.
Yes.
This is actually embedded into the glass up here.
Oh, the antenna. Yeah, the antenna. Okay. Right. That. I don't know if you hope you guys see that line. I just don't notice that. Yeah. So in my car, the antenna, I can't show you because the radio don't work. The antenna goes up in the air in the back. In this, there is no antenna that you can see. It's just on this line. That's pretty cool.
Yeah,
keeps it out of the way.
I think the earlier model C5s did have the antenna, but by this time frame, a frame of reference. This wasn't that exotic because Crown Victoria's had that embedded into the glass in the back.
So what you're saying is Ford beat us to it, huh? That's a shame.
Yeah.
You said the steering wheel has something that your Dodge Challenger doesn't have either that you love.
All steering wheels have got tilt and telescoping. However, this one has got what they call power telescoping. And when I ran the RPO codes, it actually had that as an option.
Wow, I don't have that.
And while we're talking about it, it's actually got memory seats.
Oh, so nice.
Once you program it in, the seat position as well as what the steering wheel position, and then when you turn the car off, it automatically tracks to make it a little bit easier to
get out. Yeah, that's nice. I knew they had that in newer cars. I didn't know that was back in 2004, though.
I did not know that
either. That's really nice. So this is, here's all your, like, your trip stuff, right?
Yep.
Your gauges, fuel.
Yep.
Yeah, that's where it is on my car, too.
Yeah, I think the button configuration might be slightly different, but same basic
concept.
It is,
yeah, it's a little different, but we'll go over and take a look at that then. This is kind of similar to what he had in his car, where you have all your trip stuff here, your tripodometer, your engine metrics, like from miles per hour to kilometers per hour, the range you have left, and then, of course, your resets right here.
That was actually one of the first things that I did whenever I got my car. I ran it down to where the reserve actually came on.
Oh, yeah.
Because I had no idea how old that gas was in there.
Yeah.
So I wanted to try to get it as much out, and then I put a ball of fuel injector cleaner
in there. I don't blame you there. Yeah, that's actually pretty smart.
But when you're driving, it says immediately get gas. It does make you a hair nervous.
Yeah, I bet. So you've had this car now for a little over a month.
Yep.
What's your favorite thing about it? Well, like not taking into account your other vehicles.
I think it really is all about the smiles per gallon.
Yeah,
it is a very smooth power delivery.
Notice he said smiles per gallon, not miles per gallon. He likes the smiles. He does like the miles per gallon too. It's actually pretty good.
The Challenger is a great car in its own right, but it's a bigger, heavier vehicle. Mm-hmm. You know, you do have a little bit more creature comforts because as you can see, my elbow is actually encroaching over here. I don't have that in another car. But if you just look at the smooth power delivery, and I can tell you that from past experience, this thing handles curves extremely well.
Yeah.
And that's partially due to the magnetic ride control right here as well.
Which, you guys know, I have this in my car, except mine has three options, but mine does not work and hasn't worked since I bought the car, but his does. Can you tell a difference?
A little bit.
I've heard it's not much.
Well, once I got the new tires on, I could actually tell a little bit more.
Okay. So here's the selective ride control that he has in his. Now, again, he only has two options, where I have three. I have Tour, Sport, and Performance. Now, you have...
I think I have Tour and Sport.
Okay, Tour and Sport. They don't have the Performance on there.
So one thing that this car's got is active handling.
Okay.
So it's basically traction control. It's similar to your car. However, if you hold the button in for a series of time, it actually goes to competitive driving.
Oh, wow. I see that. Right there. Competitive driving. Now, that's pretty cool.
And what that basically means, you still have traction control, but it's kind of like the setting has been dialed back 30 or 40%. It's enough to still help you keep out of trouble,
okay,
but you can definitely tell, so the car will kind of move a little bit more and stuff like that.
Nice.
That's basically the set points have been adjusted for the computer.
I want to go over and sit in the driver's seat just for a second to show you what I love about this car, but that I actually absolutely hate with a passion about my car. The dash in this car is gorgeous. I know I'll probably get a lot of hate for this, but I actually despise digital dashes. I don't like how my speedometer goes from like 0 to 60. It'll be like 0, 18, 24, 35. I want to see this needle like climb the whole way. And you don't ever get to see that in the C4 because it's all digital. This analog is what I wish so bad I had in my car, and I don't. But if you want an analog dash, the C5 would definitely be giving you that, because this is beautiful. See how mine's all digital? Now, you do have the analog RPM gauge here. The tachometer. I got yelled at for saying that the wrong way one time. The tachometer is analog. And then, of course, the battery stuff is all analog as well. But the speedometer is what I wish more than anything was analog, and it's not. One thing I did notice about this, though, is that the fuel gauge does not show you what side of the car the fuel cap is on, which in my experience with all cars I've ever driven and had, they always have an arrow to tell you which side. But I guess when you have a Corvette, you should probably be pretty smart anyways, and you just know what side it's on, right?
Well, you can always do a burnout to go to the opposite lane at the pump.
Yeah, there you go. That'd be perfect. As long as you don't like hit a concrete barrier or something. The door sills, Matt said, was something he noticed. Is like when you open up his car, you don't have near of a much of like a bucket to get down into. Whereas here, like from here to here on my car, you can see, hopefully you can see, that's probably about 10 to 12 inches there of space, of depth there, where his car does not have that.
Because you gotta look at people that are probably 60.
Oh yeah, you know, that's the generation. Like, oh wow, it is a lot different.
I think this is in the range of 4 inches. You've probably seen some different videos of how you get in and out. I will say that it's a little bit easier. So on his, it's almost kind of like a bathtub.
Yeah, exactly.
This one's kind of interesting because you can actually just get in here like this.
Yeah.
It's right there.
Yeah, and I can't really do that too much. If I was a lot thinner, I probably could do that, but that's not. But you can see here, guys, like literally about 4 inches, 5 inches of space there. I mean, that's a lot different than the C4.
And relatively speaking, they're about the same ride height.
Okay.
For the ground.
Okay, that's interesting.
Yep. There's different ways they could do it.
Yeah.
13 years later.
And as you guys can see, that he does have the Bose system in here, which is on all Corvettes as far as I know. I think in the C4s it was like an option, but I think the C5s it became standard.
I believe so.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
And similar to how all C4s have got a black interior up to a certain point.
Okay.
That's the same way with the C5s. It's only if you have a tan interior, you know, something else that you see this. So this part, this dash, this console is all the same. That kind of helps standardize parts and stuff like that. It also makes it easier to find spare parts.
Yeah, exactly.
So you're really only looking at seats, carpet, D-seals, that.
Okay. Yeah. And you guys can see here too, like the jam itself from here to here on this car is about, what, 10 inches? And on this car, it's not quite, it's probably about 7 to 8 inches. It's not near as wide right here in the C4s. One thing that my C4 does not have that this does is this random black box on the dash. Now, you're probably wondering what that is. Now, a lot of you that are Corvette fans know exactly what it is, but if you're not a Corvette fan, you're watching this video for the first time with Corvettes, it is a heads-up display. So basically, in case you guys have never seen one, if you're sitting here looking straight out the steering wheel, right up here, like in midair, you're gonna see your speed. Is this your RPM too?
Yep.
Your RPM, and it's usually like a greenish tinted color. The newer Corvettes, of course, are all colored. You have all the crazy different colors, but in this, it's just one color, right?
Yeah.
It's green.
Yeah.
But you'll see it like in floating in midair. It's really cool. You don't gotta look down at your dash.
Yeah, a lot of the GM vehicles this era had it, like Cadillacs had it and stuff like that. They use nighttime vision was one thing.
Okay.
And that's kind of part of that package. So one of the things that I think is hilarious about this car, especially when you consider how much this was when it was built, was
you know, you expect a little creature comforts. And why in the world do you have an aluminum brake and clutch, which is awesome, by the way, but then you cheap out on the dead pedal and the gas pedal?
Yeah.
And on top of that, I think this is the same floor mat that's out of a Chevrolet Impala in that area.
Wow, yeah, that's pretty bad. Speaking of that, that reminds me, like the C6 ZR1s actually had the same steering wheel that the Chevy Cobalt had in them, which is, I mean, that's pathetic. I mean, come on, GM, what the heck you doing to us here? We're buying a Corvette, not a piece of junk.
Yeah, I actually like the steering wheel, and kind of speaking of that, you know, yeah, the horns, actually, you can press it wherever you, so when you get off, it doesn't matter where you put it, you can go off.
Yeah.
Yours.
Oops, that was pretty loud. That's a lot louder than mine.
You just have it here on the
yes,
side.
Yes, I have little buttons here and here, which I cannot show you because my horns do not currently work. I need to get them fixed for to pass inspection next year.
In the words of Homer Simpson, when you get mad, yeah, you'll be able to find a horn.
Yep. And then here's the horns we were talking about in the C5 as well. My horn buttons are on either side of the steering wheel. And as you can see, oh, of course it's going to work now. Didn't work the whole way here. Well, it's working now. But they're my horns.
And I think that means your horn works. It's probably your contacts.
Yeah, I've watched videos on it. In the C5, he has this. I have this in the C4. His is all automatic. Like, you know, when it's dark and you have a car behind you, it's bright, you can flip this thing up. Well, I don't have that in mind, the automatic. I just have a manual. And then you have a light switch here, which turns on your lights underneath your mirror. Do you have that?
Yeah, it's actually got integrated LEDs, which was kind of high-tech for 2004.
Okay.
That's actually one thing I am going to be doing to upgrade that car is that...
LEDs make a huge difference.
If you're used to, like, the lighting that we have here in 2020, it makes it a little bit nicer to be able to see.
Definitely. And I did not actually film this on video, but I wanted to take a picture of it and it kind of explain. This is kind of something quirky about the interior-ish of the C5, is it comes with two keys, and they actually have them labeled on the back, 1 and 2. I have no idea why, I have no idea what the difference is. Both keys look identical on the other side, but that's just the way they did it, and I don't know why. If you guys do know why, Matt and I are very interested in knowing, so please let us know. But this was one thing that was extremely weird about the C5 and their way they had their keys. And that about does it for the C4, C5 interior comparisons. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I hope you guys maybe saw something you didn't know before. If you guys don't own Corvettes, I'm sure you've learned a lot. Let me know your comments. I love reading your comments. I reply to every single one of them as I get time. So please feel free to let me know what your thoughts were. If you did like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you did not like this video, I'm sorry, but please give it a thumbs up anyways. It really helps out the channel. Please subscribe to Doulop's channel. Take care now. See you later. Bye.